Liberty Fighters Network.
Liberty Fighters Network.
Liberty Fighters Network.
Important notice. The contents of this documentary video will undoubtedly disturb all anti-Jacob Zuma supporters. These revelations were submitted under oath in the matter between the Electoral Commission of South Africa, IEC, versus Umkhonto we says we MK Political Party, and Jacob Kirilikisha Zuma, Constitutional Court Case Number CCT 97 of 24, but has been deliberately withheld from public knowledge. These and other related court documents are available on the official website of Liberty Fighters Network, LFN, at www.libertyfighters.org and on our Telegram platform at Liberty Fighters News for your scrutiny. Reyno De Beer, the president of LFN, has officially declared his willingness to testify and present further damning evidence to any judicial commission of inquiry and to undergo an independent polygraph test to validate his revelations. This documentary is presented in several parts. Should these videos be removed from any social media platform, they remain accessible directly on our website.
Result, the following order is made. The applicant is granted leave to appeal directly to this court. It is declared that Mr. Zuma was convicted of an offence and sentenced to more than 12-month imprisonment for purposes of Section 47(1)(e) of the Constitution and is accordingly not eligible to be a member of and not qualified to stand for election to the National Assembly until 5 years have elapsed since the completion of his sentence. The order of the Electoral Court is set aside and replaced with the following, and I quote, the appeal is dismissed, close quotes. The counter application is dismissed. There is no order as to costs in this court. I hand down the judgment.
I was so shocked when on Monday, the 20th of May, 2024, the Constitutional Court ruled that Jacob Zuma may not be a candidate in the upcoming elections 2024. Now, for you who did not watch part one of the series, please go and do so. At least just read the description to that video. Are there comments underneath that video saying that the video was too long? They lost me along the way. But unfortunately for the importance of sharing the evidence, the actual evidence that we require to make an informed decision, I cannot make my videos shorter. I need to show you the proof. I need to share it with you. Otherwise, you're not going to believe me. Because unfortunately, it is much easier to believe a lie than believing someone who is telling you and showing you the proof that you have been lied to. And that is where I come in. I need to go and prove that I am right. Because the narrative out there suggests totally something different. And I need to rectify the position. Because South Africans and Africans and the entire world have been lied to. The mainstream media in South Africa has intentionally blacked out this valuable information I'm sharing with you. And at least just go and read the descriptions if you are one of those who can easily watch 2 hours of a Hollywood movie, but you find it difficult to watch an hour's worth of valuable information shared with you so that you can decide what is the correct position. So let me continue with part two, and part two is going to be more shocking than part one. Because in part two, I'm going to show you how there was alleged corruption in the imprisonment case of Jacob Zuma and also in my Supreme Court of Appeal case, where both of us were found guilty of contempt of court, but we were never afforded the opportunity to be heard. And unfortunately, yes, Jacob Zuma was sentenced to 15 months imprisonment and had to go to jail. In my Supreme Court of Appeal case, my matter was referred to the National Director of Public Prosecutions, and eventually, after very strange things also happened, they decided to prosecute me. And for the past 2 years, since 2022, I am prosecuted. I'm being prosecuted at the Bloemfontein Magistrates Court for contempt of court suggested by the Supreme Court of Appeal. And I need to show you what connection there is between Jacob Zuma's case and my own case. So let me start off. During mid-2021, three very important court judgments were rendered in the same week. And all three of them had direct links with Cyril Ramaphosa. The first one, and the one most important, most probably, is the one on 29 June 2021 by the Constitutional Court, which resulted in the imprisonment of him on charges of contempt of court. And let me just show you that one first. This is the Zuma Commission. This is an attachment to the African Union complaint I've lodged on behalf of Jacob Zuma sometime in, on the 19th of January 2022. And that is Secretary of Judicial Commission. That's the Zondo Commission against Jacob Zuma and Minister of Police and National Commissioner of the South African Police Services and Helen Suzman Foundation. That's the citation that's decided on 29 June 2021. And that was the one where he was sentenced to imprisonment. This was that he is guilty of contempt of court and is sentenced to undergo 15 months of imprisonment. That was the first one. And then the second one is the one that I was involved in as a respondent in the Supreme Court of Appeal, where the Minister of Cooperative Governance and Traditional Affairs, Nkosazana Dlamini-Zuma, at that time, was successful with her appeal against the judgment dated the 2nd of June 2020 of the High Court in Pretoria by Justice Norman Davis, declaring the COVID-19 Disaster Management Act regulations as unconstitutional and invalid. Now, in this case, and let me just show you that matter so that you know this is a fact. Supreme Court of Appeal, Minister of Cooperative Governance, Reyno De Beer, Liberty Fighters Network. It was heard on the 26th of May, 2021. And yes, so this was that case. Now, in that matter, it wasn't Dr. Dlamini Zuma who was actually behind that entire case. When the government had the setback in the High Court in Pretoria, immediately President Cyril Ramaphosa stepped in and he replaced the advocate on that matter with his own trusted Wim Trengove. So Wim Trengove took control over the entire case, and Dlamini Zuma was basically said that, "I don't trust you, you've screwed up this case. I'm going to take control over this because the COVID-19 narrative is so important for us. I am the one who's supposed to enforce and make sure that everything goes well with the COVID-19 narrative. And I'm replacing you on this case, and you must just sign off on whatever is going to be put before you, and you just keep quiet. I'm in control." That was Cyril Ramaphosa on that matter. So what happened was that in that judgment of mine, I inter alia, besides the fact that the Supreme Court of Appeal, the judges in that matter, they found that the appeal must be upheld, and it set aside the 2nd of June 2020 judgment under extremely suspicious circumstances. They went ahead and they made a ruling that I was contemptuous about a certain subject, so in a certain way, but that incident that they found me guilty of for contempt of court happened after the hearing. It did not happen before then. What transpired was that on the 26th of May 2021, there was a hearing. There were complications with that hearing. The judges were supposed to attend to a recusal application that I have submitted on behalf of Liberty Fighters Network as well on the Monday, asking the recusal of the entire bench for specific valid reasons. And the bench on the Wednesday declining to hear that application and just proceeded without hearing that matter. So there was a great urgency that that case had to be proceeded with on the Wednesday, on that very day, the 26th of May. So we did not participate in that because we said that we cannot participate in a case where the judges were requested to recuse themselves and they did not even attend to the application itself. So all the proceedings following would be null and void, would be illegal. So we did not participate further in that hearing. They continued as if we were never there. Now, after that hearing in June, I'm not sure which date it was. I think it was on the 9th of June, around there. I received a letter from the registrar of that court, Mr. Paul Myberg, apologizing for not sending certain documentations which were forming the basis of the recusal application, that he said that apparently he did not forward it to President Maya at that point in time. She's now the Deputy Chief Justice, apparently the favorite to become the Chief Justice of South Africa. So he did not forward those documents before the hearing to her. So then I was sitting there and I wondered, okay, what was going on here? And I then lodged a formal complaint to Justice Maya, requesting her to investigate the circumstances of the hearing and that she is then empowered to, before judgment is rendered, to rectify it, and so that we can be put in the position that we can then proceed with the hearing of the recusal application and then proceeding with the remainder of the case. So what Justice Meyer then did was she responded to say that she's going to investigate the conduct of the registrar by the chief registrar, Mrs. van der Merwe, but she's not going to do anything about what transpired on that hearing and the fact that the judges did not hear my recusal application, and I must just simply wait for the judgment. So regrettably, I was so furious at that point in time, and I've responded to the ongoing qualified privileged communication between me and her, in which I have reported the misconduct by the judges sitting on the case and of the registrar, and she just chucked it out of the window. She thought that it's not important, and then I've reacted in a regrettable way. However, I am certain that I am still innocent of contempt of court. But Jacob Zuma's case was then utilized in that following judgment on the 1st of July to find me guilty of contempt of court. But in that case, it was a bit different in that they said that the registrar, the one guilty of not doing his work, must forward the judgment to the director, National Director of Public Prosecutions, to consider prosecuting me for contempt of court or for whatever. So eventually she did decide, or via the Director of Public Prosecutions, the Free State, decided to prosecute me, and those proceedings are still continuing. After 2 years that I'm also representing myself in that very matter, and the proceedings are still continuing, trying to find me guilty of contempt of court. And then the third interesting judgment that came out that very week was also on the 1st of July, the so-called CR17 judgment. Now, the CR17 judgment was a matter before the Constitutional Court by the public protector of that time, the very hated advocate Mukubani, was subsequently dismissed. And there was also the economic freedom fighters who were involved in that case. But it's against the President of the Republic of South Africa, and the judgment also came out on the 1st of July. Now, what link was here? That number one, we know that that Cyril Ramaphosa and Jacob Zuma are not sitting around the same table, that Cyril Ramaphosa has been pushing the prosecution of Jacob Zuma for so-called corruption charges. And we know what was going on with the Zondo Commission, and also the repeated accusations in the media, fueled in the media, constantly negative towards Jacob Zuma, and now also against the MK party. So there's this pattern. And then obviously in my case, he took control over the matter instead of Dlamini Zuma. And then obviously the third one he was personally involved in. But there was another connection in all three of those cases. And that connection comes in the format of an organization called the Council for the Advancement of the South African Constitution, CASAC. Now, what makes CASAC so important? Let me show you this, why CASAC had its clause in these proceedings of Jacob Zuma, myself, and also CR17. Let me show you what CASAC is so that you can consider. And that is, let me first go to, there is the annual report. This was a report published physically by the Council for the South African, for the Advancement of the South African Constitution, CASAC, abbreviated. Now, these are their own documents. So, Advisory Council. So, this was published in that document. Now, who are members of CASAC? They are identified. So you physically become, when you become a member, you become a member of the Advisory Council as well. So, and I will show you the proof of that. Very importantly, let's start off with Tshepo Motsepe. Who is Tshepo Motsepe? Tshepo Motsepe is the first wife. The wife of President Cyril Ramaphosa. And Tshepo Motsepe, Dr. Tshepo Motsepe, is also the sister of the well-known business billionaire Patrice Motsepe. Okay, so that's one. Then we've got very important legal experts. There's Pierre de Vos. Pierre de Vos is very prominent when it comes to constitutional law. He's always on the television. He hates Jacob Zuma. He's openly negative about Jacob Zuma all the time, every time when he's asked to render comments. And yeah, he was also a very important driving force of the COVID-19 narrative. And then we've got Tembeka Ngcukaitobi, senior counsel. He was also the senior counsel for the IEC, the Electoral Commission, during the last Constitutional Court matter. And then we've got a Wim Trengove here. He was on our case. He was appearing on behalf of the Minister of Cooperative Governance and Traditional Affairs, aka President of South Africa. And then there was another person, Geoff Budlender. He's also senior counsel, very prominent. And I'll show you why I've identified Tembeka, Wim, and Geoff specifically. And obviously Tshepo Motsepe, because she's the wife of Cyril Ramaphosa. So CASAC has got direct ties with the president in various ways, and I'll show you that. Now, let's get back to the first Jacob Zuma's case, which is now obviously applicable in this matter. But everything that I'm mentioning here is going to show you the suspected corruption that took place. But this must already have red lights flickering that Cyril Ramaphosa is involved in this entire matter. And let me show you this, that in Jacob Zuma's case, remember that there were three cases in the imprisonment saga of Jacob Zuma. There was, firstly, this case. The Zondo Commission took Jacob Zuma to the Constitutional Court, and quickly you will see that amicus curiae, Council for the Advancement of South African Constitution. So CASAC was directly involved in the imprisonment saga of Jacob Zuma, but it goes further. Now, this one was, I call it the instigating case. So on the 28th of January 2021, the Constitutional Court, in absence of appearance of Jacob Zuma, decided that he must attend the Zondo Commission to be a witness and to testify, that he was compelled to do so. So in this case, The Secretary of the Judicial Commission of Inquiry obtained an order against Jacob Zuma that he must attend. Now, what is further important besides the fact that CASAC was a party to those proceedings? Let me show you who were the legal counsel on that case, and you're going to be shocked. Firstly, on behalf of the Zondo Commission, Tembeka Ngcukaitobi, SE, was the senior counsel for the Zondo Commission. Okay. So he was representing the Zondo Commission, but he was also, at that very time, and still is, a member of CASAC, who was a party, an amicus curiae, a so-called friend of the court in those very proceedings. And let me show you this. Let me go to our court case to see the link. So, who were the parties to... there it comes. Counsel for the Advancement of the South African Constitution was also the first amicus curiae. So they were physically allowed to be a friend of the court, thereby pushing the president's interest in this matter. But let me go to the representatives in that very case. There it is, that Wim Trengove SE represented the Minister of Cooperative Governance, aka President Cyril Ramaphosa, and he's a member, I showed you that he's a member of CASAC, and CASAC in that very case was represented by Geoff Budlender. So CASAC was also involved, so there was this link with Wim and Geoff, and they're all members also of CASAC. So the amicus was also Wim Trengove, who appeared on behalf of the government, in that case, the president. He was also a member of one of the parties pushing for the appeal to be successful against our order that we obtained on the 2nd of June 2020. And then let's go quickly to the third case of importance, the CR17 case. Although CASAC was not a member or participating specifically in that case of CR17, let me just go to who were there. There was Stephen Budlender, the son of Geoff Budlender. He was appearing on behalf of the third applicant, who was the third applicant, was Amabugani. Okay. And then let's look at the team for the first respondent, President Cyril Ramaphosa, Wim Trengove, and Tembeka Ngcukaitobi. So President Cyril Ramaphosa's legal team, Wim Trengove and Tembeka Ngcukaitobi. Sorry, I'm an Afrikaner boer, and I struggle to pronounce his surname, and apologies for doing that. But Wim and Tembeka were the legal counsel for Cyril Ramaphosa, and they were also members of CASAC. And let me show further in the other cases of Jacob Zuma, where it becomes very prominent further, that in the other cases presented before the African Union to, or the African Commission to also consider, I've showed you in that case, in the first instigating case, counsel for the advancement of the SA, of CASAC was a party. And then also in the subsequent, after Jacob Zuma was found guilty, his legal team, which is also Dalim Pofu, the same one who represented him in the before the Constitutional Court in this very matter, he was also involved in the rescission application thereafter, to trying to convince the Constitutional Court that they were wrong in sending him to prison. So in that very case, CASAC also intervened as an amicus. So CASAC was a party to those very proceedings. But I have to show you who was the counsel on that matter. I just want to go to the end here of the Zondo Commission. The first and the second respondents were represented by Tembeka Ngcukaitobi for the Zondo Commission. And the second respondent in that matter was also Raymond Zondo himself. So Raymond Zondo himself, the Chief Justice, was represented by Tembeka. And at the same time, when CASAC was also an amicus curiae to those very proceedings. During the same period as all these cases, there was another case which happened, which was extremely important to the liberty of South Africa. And it just went on in a very suspicious way, as I will tell you what happened. And eventually, it turned out to, according to me, prove that there was collusion going on between Cyril Ramaphosa, CASAC, and the judiciary. And this is very serious, people, that I'm, by making these accusations, I have to back it. And let me show you the proof that I have. And what better proof can one have than an actual court case that was determined? Let me show you this. And this is going to just make you amazed by how openly corruption is going on. And apparently, there's Jacob Zuma is being accused of corruption, but the corruption by others are just sidelined, and it does not exist because the media doesn't want to tell you this. But let me tell you what has happened, and let me just put it that all these are allegations. So it has not been proved yet in a court of law, but as I've indicated before, that I am prepared to testify under oath before a relevant judicial commission, or court or any other authority, and I'm even willing to undergo a public polygraph test to prove what I'm saying here. So let me go into this court case which occurred during that very same time. Now, in during that same time, in the High Court of South Africa, Gauteng Local Division, Johannesburg, CASAC, as the applicant, lodged an application against the Judicial Service Commission, the President of the Republic of South Africa, and then certain judges, and also an advocate, who were all nominees for certain positions in courts. But what stands out here is Dianathi Pillay and David Nat Unterhelter. Those two are the critical ones that I'm going to go into. But what this was all about is that in respect of those two, CASAC popped in after the decision in April of the JC not to put Justices Pillay and Unterhelter on the shortlist for positions in the Constitutional Court. CASAC then proceeded to launch this review application in the High Court in Johannesburg to review the decision of the JC. So they physically went to court, CASAC went to court, and they said that the decisions of the JC not to include Justices Pillay and Unterhelder on the shortlist for the Constitutional Court were incorrect. So they wanted to negotiate a special favor for Justices Pillay and Unterhelder to be on the to be on the shortlist for the candidate as a judge in the Constitutional Court. So they have arranged, that whole process was to arrange a special benefit for these two judges. And let's go to who were representing CASAC then. The counsel for the president, the advocate who represented the CASAC, who is also a member of CASAC, and who is also the counsel for the president of South Africa, to wit, let me show you this. This is a case management meeting held on the 30th of June. This case was issued, I believe, early in June 2021. I will get to the notice of motion now. But important here is that CASAC was represented by Advocate Tembeka Ngcukaitobi, and then also Advocate Muriani. He is also another advocate for the president. But a notice of motion, let me show you this. Council for the Advancement of CASAC. This was issued on the 3rd of June 2021. And they were asking that the Judicial Commission, Service Commission decision announced in April 2021 to list the 37th respondents in terms of Section 174 for the appointment of two judges to the Constitutional Court is reviewed, declared invalid, and set aside. Okay, so that was the 3rd of June. 3rd of June 2021. During the same time, I've showed you that CASAC was involved physically in the instigating case of Jacob Zuma and also physically as a party in the rescission application. And while justices, and I have to show you this so that you can understand the actual problem here, I go to, this was the imprisonment. This was the instigating case, the imprisonment case of the Zondo Commission, represented by Tembeka, the 29th of June. Let's just look at this. It came out on the 29th of June. Justice Pillay, look at that. Justice Pillay was sitting on the bench. Justice Pillay was sitting on the bench at the same time when CASAC, on the 3rd of June, brought an application to the High Court in Johannesburg to benefit her. She was sitting on that case, and also in the subsequent rescission application, there's the rescission application which was after the imprisonment sentence, she was also sitting on that bench. Pillay was sitting there. That judgment only came out, this is very important, on the 17th of September 2021. And during this case, CASAC was a party to those proceedings. CASAC was a party to those proceedings. At the very same time when Pillay was sitting on that case and CASAC was busy negotiating a benefit for her in the Johannesburg High Court. That is corruption, people. That is corrupt. Justice Pillay was supposed to recuse herself not only from the rescission application, but also from the actual imprisonment case. At the time when CASAC, who was a party to those proceedings, was busy pondering that case. And who were the counsel during those cases? For the Zondo Commission, I've showed you that none other than there it is during that very case. Tembeka was the counsel for the Zondo Commission and for Chief Justice Zondo. At the very same time, he was also the counsel for CASAC at the Johannesburg High Court in the review application. People, that is the reality we are facing. And we know that Pillay was part of the quorum or which have found Jacob Zuma guilty. And we know that Pillay was on the rescission application, which dismissed the rescission application by Jacob Zuma at the same time of the CASAC case in Johannesburg. Now to go a step further, and where David Unterhalter comes in. While CASAC had been pondering or had been involved in pushing the case in Johannesburg, which was instigated on the 3rd of June 2021, I have to show you that CASAC was a party in our proceedings, and David Unterhalter was sitting as a judge at the same time as CASAC, which is a party to our proceedings, have been negotiating a benefit for him to be on the shortlist of the position for the Constitutional Court. The involvement of Pillay and Unterwelter on those benches makes the entire judgments to be questionable. They were part and parcel of the decisions taken by those judges sitting on those cases to ponder those respective matters. And regrettably, both of them knew about that review application, and they decided not to recuse themselves from further proceedings. Not once in the judgments of Jacob Zuma, and not once in the judgment in my matter before the court, was there at no point any indication that they considered to remove themselves as they were supposed to. The fact that CASAC pushed the narratives against Jacob Zuma in those cases, and Pillay was sitting there, and at the same time they were busy negotiating a benefit for her in the High Court in Johannesburg, and also on my side, while CASAC was in support of the uphold the appeal, the narrative by President Cyril Ramaphosa, while they were party to those proceedings, David Unterwelter was busy pondering the decision in that case, which only came out in the 1st of June. And I have even, in the Johannesburg proceedings, they have even indicated that he did, or he has personally indicated that he abided by the decision of the court, so he did accept it. Irrespective of the fact that he abided by the decision of the court, that was a benefit being organized by CASAC for him, and he eventually found, or the bench found, in favor of the appeal to be upheld. I will, in another episode, in another part, describe the events of the proceedings before that court in Johannesburg, which is going to also be amazing. It just shows how, when you are in the right direction, how judges simply come together and the legal fraternity comes together to maneuver themselves to protect. And it's going to be very interesting, which I have to share with you. But I just, for purposes of this video part two, I just want you to understand. And I will understand the alleged corruption that went on in the imprisonment saga of Jacob Zuma, which was also connected with my case. In the subsequent part, I will also specifically address the current electoral court proceedings that we have engaged on Thursday to physically report or request the electoral court to investigate all the IEC members, and that the content of that application that we've launched is also going to be very interesting to follow. Take care. Godspeed.
Liberty Fighters Network.
Liberty Fighters Network.
Liberty Fighters Network.